listening to both of you, it seems architecture is no longer intimate to us. It seems we are here and architecture is over there, which Juhani just, lucidly mentioned that for us. And though she mentions that, he mentioned this yesterday, that we never thought that that building will be separate from us. But yet it is. That's how it has come down too. As Juhani was mentioning a little earlier, there's no longer the interaction that an existential kind of relationship with the buildings should have. Architecture has become a detached thing that can be molded, sculpted, measured, valued, devalued, but disengaged from this primordial relationship to the body. So perhaps what I would like to ask both of you, how do we proceed from here? What should be the methodical and thoughtful way to overcome this?
I'm just wondering, where does rhythm come from?
Where does what?
Rhythm. The music, the sound.
Rhythm comes from our body, heart, primarily heart, but there are also other rhythms.
Yes, so if that is the case, then will that be part of the beginning of the creation?
I would say absolutely yes. One of the basic problems is that our entire culture has forgotten that we are embodied beings and that we are also animals, as we have earlier discussed. Artists usually have, through history, they have defended, and architects defended this, human being as an entity, complete entity, unifying the mental and the physical. But somehow in today's world of cruel competition and cruel competition particularly for visibility, somehow artists and architects have stepped outside of themselves, and they work on art and architecture as it were a kind of a sensual or sensory game through which to excite or allure viewers. I don't see at all that as the task of the artists or architects' work. We visited today an extremely alluring work, that is the Parliament building.
Yes.
But it's on a completely different level. One sitting there or walking there, one really realizes one's, ground, one's roots in the long history.
Actually, when we went this morning, I was just remembering Lu Khan's drawings in his office. While he was drawing them, and when he was drawing, first of all, the tracing paper on which he would use his charcoal, he would not even touch the charcoal with his the paper, because it would hurt the paper. So it would almost float. And in this floating, his body, mind, everything else is connected to the charcoal and the paper. And at that time, what comes out from those two relationships is a line or a curve or a triangle or maybe a one single vertical line. And I think the entire body is part and parcel of that drawing. And I think that is where the aesthetics or the art or the joy has come. Mm. So it is a total bodily experience, like what Henry Moore talks about.
Yes, yes.
So it is the whole question of aesthetics is not independent, aesthetics is embedded in our life itself.
I would also suggest a further step to, in addition to going back to drawing, going back to using charcoal and pencil, which express presser, they express certainty and uncertainty. Hesitation has to be, you know, visible on the drawing, but yeah. When you draw with, you know, today's pencils that result in an equal line, there is no hesitation. In the computer drawing, definitely there is no hesitation. But hesitation is something, the creative process is a dialogue.
Actually, the purpose of drawing is not knowing what you are drawing, and you are waiting for the chance inside you. And that chance inside you draws this, and you have a chance to correct. Yes. So the charcoal is then immediately effaced.
Yes.
And you come back again, like the old slate. And now, if you are going to get a computer, yes. And if you are going to ask the computer to draw, computer can't draw, so you have to give numerical instructions.
Yes.
And then, you know, it will draw, and that drawing and you are far distantly disconnected. Yeah. And that is where the aesthetic disappears.
Can I add a story here? This is related by a student of Khan in his office. So the student is working on a drawing, and Khan would typically come in, and he would look at the drawing and make stabs with charcoal, typically. And he had a piece of charcoal in his hand. And he was also smoking a thin cigar. So there was Khan, this thin cigar, working with the charcoal. And the student looking at the drawing, the movement of his hand, and eventually he does not see the drawing anymore, he sees the cigar. It's burning, the ash is turning longer and longer, and it's about to fall. And it falls on the piece of paper. Khan keeps on moving his hand, the charcoal and the ash. So, this engagement of the body.
Can I just say one more sentence about charcoal and pencil? It's very significant for the creative process, for the dialogue between the imaginative world and the real physical world on the paper is the thickness of the line.
That's right.
If you use a sharp pencil, you can't think with it because it doesn't allow you any space for, you know, choosing.
It doesn't have dimensions.
Yes, yes. Charcoal drawing is spatial. It gives feelings of light and shadow. It becomes a plastic process rather than just a linear process. Sorry.
No, but Juhani, perhaps you might help us understand it a little bit more because you have thought about this deeply, beginning from Merleau-Ponty's notion of the lived body. I think this is something not very clear to all of us. The distinction from the biological body, the body as we typically know it to be, the anatomical body, versus the notion of the lived body and this idea of embodiment. Perhaps quickly. Well,
the lived body is the experience of our being in the world, which is a total experience, has mental and physical components. And then the idea that Merleau-Ponty suggested, the flesh of the world, which is such a beautiful notion and also so dramatic that we are part of this flesh of the world, which means the world is not alien to us. We are part of the same flesh. So it is this lived flesh of the world that I'm talking about when I'm speaking of the body, rather than, you know, an anatomist would define human body.
think the anatomist would think of the body as a kind of independent, isolated body.
Yes.
While liveness would mean that I'm in a space always.
Yes,
and there's an interpenetration of the body and space.
It's a dialogical concept.
The other thing that comes to mind are, you know, I think both of you, in one way or another, is asking us to rethink the architectural task.
Sorry, what was that?
The architectural task, rethinking the architectural task. And you have written about it, and Doshiji talks about it. You know, when you say that architecture needs to return to life, which is already like demanding a new task for us, how do we do that when we see architecture being discussed or understood, you know, perhaps in three tiers? One is architecture as a profession, which we all seem to understand. We participate and behave along those lines, and profession dictates what needs to be done. And a big sort of output of that is formalist productions, which you have talked about. And the second one, which I think about, is architecture as a discipline, a conversation that can happen not only within architecture, but beyond architecture. You know, one is what you have just described, the work of artists, but not necessarily artists, writers, sociologists, anybody in any discipline can actually talk about architecture, and we need to make that conversation with people beyond architecture. So architecture doesn't belong to architecture only. And the third is architecture is part of the life world, and it's beautifully mentioned today, choreography of life. And you mentioned yesterday, Doshiji, Corbusier, architecture is a way of life. So they're like, you know, you need to help us understand in the audience that amongst the various ways we think about architecture, we talk about architecture, understand architecture, and that's how we behave in practice.
But supposing we don't talk of architecture.
That's right, you mentioned that.
And we draw a square, or we draw lines. And then they are almost making some kind of a form, which is, let's say, a square, roughly. A child drawing the square, a musician drawing a square, a sculptor drawing a square, and a so-called architect drawing a square. I think, and a doctor drawing a square.
Mm-hmm.
I think each one is drawing that with some kind of image inside him. And I think we never talk about that image, but we talk about the product.
Yes.
And I think that process is not talked about.
Yes.
And I think the first thing in the architectural profession is, what is the creation from a dot to the space which has a configuration?
Yes.
Whether it is a circle or a square, what is it for? What does it do? I think if that is not understood, it cannot become the volume, and then it cannot be in full dimensions. So aesthetics and joy and creation comes from gradual flowering of that one dot into something which is one's mind, but before that mind there is some kind of a view or an imagination of something which is really glorious for the person who is drawing it.
I am actually working on an, I have, together with an American professor in mathematics, initiated a project to make an exhibition on drawing, but drawing in the meaning of pulling out.
Mm.
How various, you know, professionals from mathematicians, physicists, etc., even children, they pull out something from their mental world into this world, material world, through signs and doodles and what have you. I have become interested in this second meaning of drawing, pulling out, and I think you were pointing to that direction.
Yes.
Well, you know, we in English we use one word, architecture. It has its.
I think we are talking about two abstractions. And finally, that abstraction has become an abstraction which is commercial.
Mm.
And I think that is where the difference starts.
Well, it has become an ornament.
Usefulness, and usefulness to give me life's existence through money out of that drawing, I think is quite different from what we are talking as aesthetics and creation. I think creation has no transactions. Creation is inner-related space.
Yes, and the notion of abstraction is most often misused to understand something as being something from which emotion and meaning has been taken away. No, it's the opposite. It's the absolute condensation of meaning and emotion.
I would address something that you often talk about, you know, the notion of the sacred. In designing the assembly complex, Khan struggled to define and set up a relationship between two entities, the assembly and the prayer hall. And the relationships, you know, he worked on that for a number of years before he got to where it is right now. And he worked both with the shape and size of the two entities, we know that. But that's not quite the intriguing thing. I think what I, you know, looking into the history of the project, what intrigued me, Khan described the mosque as a religious space and the assembly as the sacred space. Which, what I want to ask you is that, as you talk about the sacred, how must we think about it when modernity has trained us to be suspicious of that notion itself, if not the experience? And added to that, what's happening today as the clash of religions. So within those two contexts, you know, the clash of religions and modernity's suspicion of the sacred. How should we go about thinking about it?
Actually, it was interesting. I was in the office, in Khan's office, when this was going on. I happened to visit at that time. And the assembly is already drawn. Assembly is drawn as the sacred place, because it is the place where people are going to take a decision of a civilization in a long-term span. It's not something which is just a hall. It's a hall where debates would happen, but before the debate there is some kind of a connection of a sacred responsibility of a larger ecosystem, including the human beings. And I think that is what is supposed to be that assembly. People represent that and they are the representatives. So the chamber of the assembly becomes very sacred, as if it's a congregation of all the wise men around who are going to talk about what kind of life are you looking at and what is the glory of life. So when he was doing this, if you look at the geometry of the chamber, the main assembly building, it's quite rigorous, and then the whole question comes up is, what are the nature of the space between the walls, that is the open and the enclosure, and what is the wall and what is the other wall doing? So he was thinking about many dialogues. Today I myself was surprised after seeing it three, four times in reality, but seeing the drawings very often there with model and all that, I never realized that he was talking about the flow all the time and a dialogue between a circle and a square, or a curve or a straight line. And I think there is something called static and the dynamic. And that is something which was very important. And when you create an aperture into those, I think the dynamism not only changes, it begins to talk about beyond. So yes. When we talk of sacred, when we talk about something, there are many, according to me, that's what I think, many inherent silent processes which happen into that kind of an element which has been, we call a building, and that building indirectly seeps us through us, as if you know that a little wind comes and it blows you through the room and suddenly you are awakened. So I think when you talk about the sacred, whether it is the temple or a mosque or an assembly building, over time, when you sit there for a while, some kind of a flow is going to come there. So it's creating a sort of an indirect magnetic force, which tells you what to do.
But he makes a distinction between the sacred and the religious.
Now I'm coming to the next one. So this is what the chamber was. When he was asked to do the mosque and it had to face the west, the problem was that the axis changes slightly. And I remember he was struggling now that he has to put another building next to it and what are the ways to put. And then he works out in such a way that there the cube gets completely cut off and you get openings in the cube's edges, which was not in the other place. In the other place, those circles, the openings are in a wall. Here the opening is made into a cube, so that means that the whole structure is now being opened up so that the air from all over can come inside. This is how I see that. I don't know. But what I know of him, it must be that why would he change his method of relating a circle or opening an wall or a curved wall, and now he breaks open the cube itself. And that is also to emphasize the angle. Because when you make an angle and when you make a cube which is rigid, it would be very conspicuous and not relate. So it's like somebody who is sleeping or child is sleeping and you move slightly. And I think that is what is very wonderful about that place, that it changes. And so when it's finished and when the sunlight comes, that room changes totally.
I think that there are, in a way, two planning processes juxtaposed. When looking at the early sketches, they are like mandalas. The first level is, thinking about architecture as a true representation of the world, the mandala.
Yes, yes.
And then in the second phase comes the functional aspects. Whereas we have been taught the other way, and usually we forget the metaphysical aspect completely. You see my point?
Yes.
Yes. The early Kahn's early sketches are really fantastically mystical in the geometric complexity, which deals with the other world of ideas.
But is it possible to say that in the relationship, and it's a dialectical relationship between the assembly building and the prayer hall?
Well, it's part of
No, there is that third element, is the space between the walls, which you are not talking. Actually, the spaces between the walls are very, very important. And the way they penetrate, they go on your scale. I think they make the whole world completely different. So when we are talking about the sculpture, when you talk about the object, when does the object look as if now it has come to rest?
Yes.
It has fulfilled its commitments.
Yes, what I mean is that in the early sketches, the spaces do not seem to have function yet.
Yes.
The definition comes later. The definition of these forms and geometries in the beginning is the metaphysical one.
Yes.
Sure. I mean, Kant began with the realization, as he called it, even I think before the sketch, that assembly is of a transcendent nature.
Yes.
That began the whole thing. Right. Well, also at the same time, Juhani, you have written about, well, losses that has happened. And one loss is loss of enchantment. I don't know if it's kind of related to our, not quite loss, but the sort of suspicion of the sacred. Can that be also aligned with this loss of enchantment?
Yes, I would even suggest another notion, loss of the erotic dimension in architecture. I think we like old towns and old architecture because it is so sensuous and sensual. It has a erotic component, and whereas modernity, particularly as it has, turned in our two or three last decades, it's totally unerotic. And I think the eroticism is part of, the life world and part of our relationship with the world.
Is it not that from the spiritual, physical body to we have become a material body, so our mind doesn't think that way? Because slowly we are calculating. In a sensuous body, calculations don't come.
I didn't understand now.
Sensuous body, the physical body has many senses.
Yes, yes, yes.
And we smile and we talk and we celebrate and we love.
Yes.
A commercial mind will talk about transaction.
Yes.
So there is a transaction and a relationship.
Yes.
And when you get into the material aspects of that transaction, yes, it is completely beyond all these senses.
Absolutely.
And it is only return and supply.
Yes. This was already the point of Erich Fromm in his book, To Live or to Own, or to be or to have. And in the consumer society, we live through consumption and owning or possessing instead of living. And that's increasingly, you know, disturbing everywhere. We talked earlier today about the offensive feeling at international airports nowadays, particularly if you have to wait there several hours. It's a lot like waiting in a shopping mall, which is an horrified thought for me.
Sure, but then there was this Iranian man, Mehran Karim Nasiri.
Yes, who had to live in Paris.
In Paris, and that's the film based on his life. He lived there for 11 years.
Yes. So,
but you mentioned, you know, the sort of the erotic relationship with the city. But perhaps we might want to discuss the city a little bit. And you have mentioned that, and you know, we have always admired your work, not only the design of cities, housings, these large-scale projects, and the one you showed today and which we all know very well, Aranya. It seems that the city is the biggest challenge now, not so much as the individual architecture. And we might have to recognize this, and especially for young aspiring architects, where should their obligations be in the next 5-10 years? The city is the big challenge, socially, ethically, ecologically. I feel that while architects may make stunning buildings, the city goes to hell. There is this big sort of disjunction here, and how should we enter this issue? In the 60s and 70s, we have seen, especially in India, sort of great project with sort of social implications. The state provided support.
No, I think first of all, we should really ask question, how did the cities come into being? Because initially it is the people who made settlements. And many people made many settlements that make it clusters. And then they were doing this for their own relationships and celebrations, transactions and whatnot. Now that issue we don't talk at all. We don't talk of city, of people, or citizens, or life. But we talk of movement. We talk of faster movement and convenience. And that convenience is basically where our life has material returns. So vehicle becomes more important than the human movement. So what has happened is we have reversed the whole order of a making of a city. So that bullock cart or a donkey or a cycle or a small vehicle going across, and you didn't bother, you were important. Today, a human being is put, you know, on the 10th floor, as if, you know, it is like a honeycomb, your house there. Otherwise, he has no existence.
Yes, and another thing which is has happened a long time ago, and somewhat unnoticeably, it is the unification or standardization of everything as opposite to differentiation. it's very clear that in today's way of life, I know and follow nature and temperature and weather much less than I did as a farm boy, simply because air conditioning and heating and everything sort of pushes that those phenomena away from my consciousness, and besides standardizes them. In Finland, we live in 23 degree centigrade rooms. That's our temperature.
You know, but I can ask you a question because it is very important. Dhaka is full of water bodies.
Used to.
Dhaka has water bodies, lakes, well, whatever they are, but even today for me, they are quite a lot. I come from a desert area.
That's right.
So, you see the trees, you see the greenery, and early morning when I wake up and see from the hotel room, fantastic green landscape there, and no cars are going. Little later you see the roads, you know, gradually crowded with cars. How much, you know, when you came here at to meet us, talked about us, you thought about that nature. Where has it gone?
Sorry, but
that nature which is there here in Dhaka today in the mind of all of us has disappeared.
Yes, well, yes, but it's also disappearing in the Nordic, sensibility. We are so deeply forest people that we have a forest in our head. I have written several essays on forest architecture simply because I feel strongly, I would say I know, that our imagination has been formed by the forest condition, the spatial richness and the multi-sensory reality of the forest. But that is being also pushed away from our consciousness. So I think, it is the functionalization of things that is really the to be blamed.
I think it is prioritization of things.
Pardon me?
There is a greater priority of different things and not really life.
Yes, yes.
Not what is there. I think we don't know what our assets are. We are talking about an external thing which has become our asset and our life and our value. For example, I came here some 15 or 18 years ago. There were not many flyovers or the going round and round. And you could walk through sometime. But before that, I mean, I'm sure that one could go and then you feel the rains coming in, floods coming in, and the flowers, birds, animals. Today, you don't hear anything at all. You don't know. You are in a car. You come by plane, you come in the car, you go to the hotel, it is air conditioned, you are back. You could be anywhere. It is not, Dhaka is only the airport and friends. Otherwise, Dhaka is not there. I think that is which is very strange. I mean, it is not only Dhaka, it's all over India, all over. And that is the problem today. Our priority is completely shifted. I think the topic, you know, that we are talking about, aesthetics and joy and creation, I think the cycle is completely reversed. What are we? So can we talk about decreation or destructuring, restructuring things so that we can recreate?
Yeah. Well, let me add one more comment on that, the former subject. In Finland, we love summer houses because we want to be back to the context of nature. And half the population has summer houses and saunas. Nowadays, the tendency is to repeat the urban flat
there.
Condition. it's absurd. Why do you have them two houses if you don't have any difference between the two? We have had this possibility with my wife to have a toilet and running water and so forth, proper heating in our summer house. We have chosen never to do it because it would, wipe away the special conditions.
I mean, maybe this is a good time to ask something else. Doshiji, you talk about joy and celebration. it's part of the way you do architecture and you expect the architecture to be experienced. But Juhani, yesterday you declared quite clearly that you love melancholia.
Yes.
And you also, I think, mentioned that this is something very definitive for Finland as culturally. You know, and I was thinking that, I was thinking about Orhan Pamuk.
Yes.
In his book, Memories of Istanbul, yes. He talks about Huzun as a particular kind of melancholia that circulates. Mm. I mean, we have that in Bengali culture here also, like Bishad, Biroho, as a, you know, melancholia stemming from a kind of separation from either home place or the beloved.
Yes, yes, longing, primarily longing.
Longing.
Longing, which has been abstracted. It's not longing for something specific. It's just longing, you know.
How does that work in your sense of emotive content of architecture?
Well, the particularly in American culture, the standard is that you should be happy all the time. Mm-hmm. I don't want to appear happy when I'm not happy. I think we need to respect, you know, human freedom to the point that we express our feelings. And there are also dark and sad days and feelings. I think they should have their role and they should have their symbolism in, you know, everyday life, as they used to be. Russia has a long tradition of melancholia. Yes. That was actually the Russian writers, they were all practically melancholic.
That's why they fat novels.
Yes.
In our culture, we have festivals. And like Durga Puja is there, and we have Diwali and other festivals are there all the time. One of the important thing there is that there is sarjan, that is creation, and visarjan. Visarjan is dissolution, that you put the statues or anything else in the water and they dissolve. The reason is very simple, that then you are anticipating the reoccurrence of that event and you live into that event for the year. Mm-hmm. And slowly you come back, and that is where the real melancholia, longing comes. Mm. I think longing comes from the events which you anticipate, and then you surrender, and then again they come back. And that is that cyclic order, which I think is very significant.
The famous Russian writers of 19th century, like Dostoevsky, they were homesick. But they were not longing for a concrete home. It was just, you know, an abstracted notion of home.
I think that then we must actually make all the sort of young aspiring architects homeless first. So yearning and the erotics of home, so to speak.
Yes, and then everyone should read Crime and Punishment.
That's all. Yes, of course. I think this is my last question, or but you know, beyond that, we can open it up for some few questions from the audience, two or three. And this is really directed for, we have a number of young friends here, students, I'm sure, a lot of students. I'm going to mention the paradox in the training of architects. And we have discussed that in the last 2 days.
I think paradox is not discussed, because paradox is to say that you become creative, but within the time limit. How can it be? I will take an exam and judge myself, what is your new creation? Now the creator is not talking, but that somebody else is talking about and challenging his creation.
Right.
So what else are you asking but paradox?
Well, I'm thinking that I was going to ask you that if you want to restart the whole thing again. I mean, you have started the sort of the most well-known schools in India, and that became a paradigm of training. But then we have architects, or young architects, who aspire to become architects. In the image of something, in the following of something that you have both discussed, or Juhani especially, that is fundamentally flawed, formalist, object-based, spectacular. Mm. And, you know, we are all following that track. So what would you do to teach in first year that we discussed, the foundation year? And you said it beautifully, when the fire is lit in the heart in the first hour. Mm. So what should we be teaching them? Telling them.
I think, as I mentioned earlier, celebration is the word I like.
Melancholy a little bit?
Both. Right. No, they both come together. Without melancholy, you won't be celebrating.
That's right.
Yes.
In the
but the idea is that how do you become a child again and feel enthused about things? I think one of the most important thing is it is not an obligation. Graduation, going to the college, and then I have to get a degree, and then I have to agree that I will do for you what you like and not what I like. I think these are all stages of getting into a prison, self-imposed prison, because I am afraid otherwise I will not be survived or I will not get the respect in the society. And I think that structure itself is slowly closing in.
And you also mentioned that you would like to take the word architecture away and make them look at life.
Yes.
And you mentioned you just want to make them read for 1 year and not talk about architecture.
Yes. I was just going to say that I see teaching fundamentally in any field, but particularly the artistic fields, as a way of taking a student next to a phenomenon that is interesting and fundamental, and pointing that phenomenon to the young student. That might be a poem or a painting or a human situation.
To answer this question, there is a very interesting treatise written several centuries ago in a Sanskrit text dialogue, Vishnu Dharmottar Puran. There is a lord and then there is a disciple. The disciple is a king and the Lord is the real Lord, you know. So he prays him, so he says, I want you to be present all the time. So how can I create your image here? So the Lord says, do you know how to make an image? He says, I don't know. So he says, how will you make it? So he asks question, tell me how. He says, then do you know dance? Because dance has rhythm, dance has body, thought has everything. So if you know dance, then only you will do. So then he asks question, how do you know I don't dance? Mm-hmm. He says, do you know music? Mm-hmm. So he says, I don't know music. He says, you must learn. He says, how do I learn? He says, do you know rhythm? Then he says, I have no idea. He says, if you don't know the rhythm, then you don't know poetry. Mm. So if you don't know poetry, you don't know the language. And if you don't know the language, you should learn the alphabets. So actually, a good training is continuous in a flow, sequentially done. The person can become what he wants to become. And I think that sequence is missing in the schools.
So we might have to reinvent some of the terms instead of calling classes, you know, sustainability or graphics. We might say rhythm.
Yes.
Another class, Joy 101, Melancholia 101.
That's right, yes.
I think we are offering this for the Institute next semester.
Well, one mistake I think in the educational thinking nowadays is to try to make everything as quick and pleasant, unproblematic as
and everybody's satisfied, that sort of thing. No,
learning is suffering. You have to suffer because the purpose of learning is to change yourself. And all changes are somehow painful. You have to read what Rilke says in his beautiful book, Letters to a Young Poet.
Oh, that's a beautiful
book. Yes.
Well, okay.
Well, first of all, I want to thank the Bengal Institute and also all of you here. And without you, your invitation, I would not be here. And since
I
he's here, so
I mean, this is truly called embodiment.
Well, I must also say to Doshi, without you, I wouldn't be here.
Wow.
Well,
I wouldn't have taken the risk of coming here with my broken
that's right.
back.
That's right.
You.
Now so I have to tell you this. You know, getting this Doshi ji and Pallasmaa here was a long drawn task, and I have to say thank Marina for that. We played each other. We told Doshi that Pallasmaa may be coming. And we told Pallasmaa that, you know, Doshi will definitely be coming. And we know that Juhani had an accident 3 months ago, and, you know, it was seriously a back problem, and we were not at all sure that whether he's coming to talk or not. But thank you so much, you know, for being here. And, well, hopefully we'll
see
you again.
I think it was an enjoyable. Thank you so much. So. Thanks a lot.
So are you willing to take a couple of questions? You
know, yes,
maybe
yes.
There's some
there
really burning
questions. Yes.
There's a microphone here. So.
Thank you to everybody. I'm architect Dur Karim Nilu. Before I ask the question, I must thank these two icons, including my younger brother. He's also there.
Yes.
I have to thank him because without him, as you said, you couldn't be here. First of all, it was an excellent experience in my entire life. Hearing a lot of things that we never knew about architecture. But before that, I will ask you, both of you, to tell a very simple answer about what our young generation will start thinking from today after listening a lot of important issues on architecture. Could you please tell us, for our students here, what they will start thinking from today?
Well, first of all, they need to start thinking, I think.
I think life is not an obligation. Life is to realize who you are and what you are. And I think that is like, you know, beginning of the career, you know, when you go out and you have no responsibilities, but you have no help. You start learning on your own. And I think that kind of independence is very important. Aspirations are important. And some vision is important. I think every culture has their own icons, you know, in terms of politics, literature, scholarships. And there is every day in our culture, at least every day you go anywhere, you will find things happening. Some of them are not in our routine. People are praying, somebody is shouting, somebody is singing, and they're all together, but we never notice them. We are too busy with our thought. And second thing is, don't be ever dependent on technologies and on also outer sources. If you are dependent, then any time it can be snatched. I think these are two principal things, you know, if we can't be self-reliant.
Well, Doshi said, life is not an obligation. The world is not an obligation either. Everyone makes his or her own world. The fact that, or the feeling that we are existing in a world is a result of ourselves having created that world.
That's right.
So you have to go to all those fundamentals to the point of judging whether you have constructed your world, aesthetic world, ethical world, social world, historical world, whatever world of nature, somehow appropriately. I'm not sure that current primary education almost anywhere does that. We are so badly misguided from childhood on. So I suggest become critical to everything and scratch the surface of all things, and usually you find something that is very interesting. I am now working with a couple of neuroscientists. I, as I mentioned, have been working with psychoanalysts, etc. My only design work at the moment I have two surprising design projects. One is a community center in Sri Lanka, in Colombo, in one of the slums, and then I'm designing a perfume for a New York perfume shop. So I'm just saying, well, I tried to, you know, object to this commission when I got the telephone call that I will be 80 in a couple of weeks and my sense of smell is not that accurate anymore. So dialogue, and yeah. we will. So, I'm telling this just to tell you that getting interested in things, and then also getting kind of a humble self-assurance that you dare to do all kinds of things that you never thought about. Whenever I'm asked to write or give a lecture on something I have never thought about it, I will say immediately, yes, I will do it. And I think maintaining your sense of curiosity is the best way of fighting the negative consequences of age. So I would suggest to the young students, evoke your sense of curiosity.
Yes.
Anybody else? And you need to keep it short also, and if you want to ask in Bangla, that would be fine. I can help translate.
Thank you. My question is for Juhani. What I understand about phenomenology is it's about lived experiences. So will an architect stopped from doing what he hasn't done before? For example, if you are to task a fish market and you have never been to a fish market, so you don't know the phenomenological essence of that project, or to say build a home in Jupiter, which does not exist, so will an architect stop?
The society and clients believe today is that expertise has some value in the creative world. I would almost say it has no value. This is what Joseph Brodsky, for instance, says. A craftsman does not collect expertise but uncertainties. It's a beautiful thought, and I think it is rather the skill to tolerate uncertainty and not knowing in advance, but yet accepting the challenge, that is more important than believing that previous knowledge solves everything. For instance, if I were a priest and commissioned a church, I would rather commission someone who has never thought of designed a church than someone who has done already several, because only the one who is looking at the issue for the first time can really understand what that, you know, thing is in essence.
Yes. Thank you.
So I want to definitely thank Doshi Ji and Juhani for the time they spent with us, and I'm sure the conversations will continue in one form or another. But I also want to thank all the people who have been here throughout the afternoon, and thank all the people who have helped set this up. Spend time with Doshi Ji and Juhani for the last 3 days.